All right, guys, welcome to RC Mojo. We're back for some more Bullhead gearbox this week. We're fitting the suspension arms and the steering. Don't forget, we're building everything in step 9 to 16 twice for the two axles. So when the manual says we need 8 of something, it only takes 4 per axle. Here we go then, step 17, balls. We're going to need 4 M3 play nuts, 4 5mm ball ends, and 2 chrome arms, C8 and C10. On the inside of the arms, along the top, there's 2 hex-shaped holes for the nuts to sit in. All we need to do is insert a nut from one side and screw in the balls from the other. Nip them up with a cross wrench and, well, that's about it really. Do both arms and that's step 17 done. Step 18, and we've got a bit more going on this time, fitting the arms to the axles. This time we need 6 M3x20s, 8 M3 plain nuts, and 2 C1s that almost complete the ball cup in the arms. Before we do any assembling, we need to make sure we know which way up the C1s go. We're going to be using a bit of grease, so we don't want to get it wrong and have lots to clean up. Turns out that the nice chrome side is what ends up being visible, which makes sense, but you never know. The arm itself slots in over the axle tube to go over the balls. It might need some gentle force to pop it in place, gentle being the very important bit. If it's really stubborn, there's probably something wrong. Now we know it should fit okay, we can pop the arm off again and apply a tiny bit of grease on the face that comes in contact with the ball. We really don't need a lot, just a smear over the surface. The rest can get wiped away. I'm planning to keep this truck fairly clean, so no wet mud. The grease will help keep the squeaks and the creaks to a minimum. However, if you're planning to run in the wet and mud, you might be better off skipping the grease. It'll pick up the sand and the grit and end up wearing the plastic faster than if you just leave it dry. With what's left on the paper towel, we'll wipe a bit of grease on the end part where it sits against the ball and offer it up to the arm. On the back of the arm, there's 3 hex-shaped holes for the nuts. So all we do is insert a nut in the arm and through the end part, pop in a screw into the nut. Install all 3 so they're a little bit loose, then nip them up once everything is in position. Repeat on the other side and that's the arms complete. They should move nice and freely even without any grease. If they're really stiff, check the end parts are fitted nice and straight. Step 19, bottom bits of the ball cups and the yellow bits that keep the arms straight. For screws we need 8 3x12 self-tappers. Then for plastic, there's 2 C6s, an F8 and an F9. The C6s slot into the bottom of the arms to complete the ball cup. They're a tight fit, but they should end up being more or less flush. We don't need to add any more grease really. What's already there will be plenty. It'll just transfer around after the truck's been run a bit. To hold them in, we use 2 of the screws from the outside. Now, access is a bit of a fiddle. You have to rotate the arm so you can get to the screwdriver along the side of the axle. Do up the screws, repeat on the other side, and that's the cups complete. For the yellow bits, they just screw straight into the underside of the arms. Check you've got them the right way around though, and that you've got the right bit. F9 has an extra blind hole that we use in the next step. Give everything a quick check over, as after the next step it starts getting a bit more difficult to take things apart. Step 20, the axle braces. We need 1 3x12 self-tapper, 2 M3x6s, an M3 washer, and a left and right side axle brace. In other words, 1 long and 1 short one. For the braces, all we do is drop one into place so the threaded hole is on the outside. Then we use one of the 3x6s to fix it in place, which is easier said than done. Getting things to line up isn't as easy as it really should be. Now it was quite a long time ago, but I'm pretty sure my old clodbuster was a lot easier. I'm wondering if the jig for making the braces aren't quite as good as they were. Later in the build, I had to tweak the bends a little bit to get the inside hole even close to lining up. Install the 2 braces and nip up the screws. Next we'll install the self-tapper with the washer under its head in the blind hole in the yellow F9 part. We can screw it in a good few turns, then lift the washer so it's under the head, and then slot the plastic bracket on the gearbox in. Tighten the screw up so it's just snug and no more. If you overdo it, you can damage the plastic bracket, which is already going to have a hard time staying in one piece. Step 21, the knuckles. We need a few bits for this one. one M3 plain nut, two 6mm washers, these are the thin ones that feel more like shims, two 5mm e-clips, four 1260 bearings, two 6mm ball ends, and a 6mm ball nut. And of course the two wheel axles. For plastic, all we need is a D1 and a D2, the knuckles. If you're using the stock plastic bushings, you'll want to follow the instructions and lube up with some grease, but since we're using bearings, we can just leave everything dry. So all we do is pop a bearing over the shaft and push it in from the inside of the knuckle. Make sure it's fully seated, then flip the knuckle over and pop another bearing in from the outside. Slide one of the big shims slash washers down over the bearing, then clip in an E-clip. If you're worried about losing the clip, stick the assembly and your hand in a clear plastic bag. If the clip does ping off, it's not going to go far. Rinse and repeat with the other knuckle, and we've got a pair ready for the ball ends. If you kept track of which one's which, well done. Otherwise, compare them with the diagram so we fit the right balls to the right knuckle. For D2, the top one, we need to use a plain nut in the hex hole and one of the ball ends from the other side. On D1, rather than use the plain nut, we used a ball nut with a ball end from the other side. Nip them up and we've got a set of knuckles ready to install. Step 22, the linkages. Right, we need two M3 plain nuts, two 6mm ball ends, a short and a long linkage, four F7 rod ends, and a B2 and a B6 to make up the servo saver. We already went over how to make linkages in the first video, so we'll just cut to them being complete. Very nice. On B2, we need to pop a nut in the hex shape hole on one end and thread in a ball from the other side. For B6, it's more or less the same, except we've got a choice of three holes. Now, Tamiya used the middle hole, which I generally go along with. With most servos using the stock servo arm, you'll get close to as much steering as you can use without wheel wideners. You can always move to the outside hole later if you end up coming up a bit short. When the balls are nipped up, that's step 22 complete. Step 23, fitting the knuckles. This time we need four 4mm washers and four kingpins. Otherwise we need our axle, knuckles and the long linkage. As usual, Tamiya want us to grease all the things. This time though, we will be greasing a couple of bits. The washers sit in recesses in the knuckles, which is all well and good, but they do have a tendency to fall out while you're trying to fit them. We'll use a couple of tiny smears of grease just to keep them in position, using the grease to stick them in. We don't really need any on the kingpins, and certainly not on the dog bones. The grease is going to attract dirt and grind everything away in no time. With the washers stuck on, we can slide the knuckles into the end of the axle and install the two kingpins. Now it's important that the knuckles can steer smoothly. There should be very little friction in an ideal world. Backing off the kingpins an eighth of a turn usually does the trick. If they're a little bit stiff, don't worry too much though, they will free up a little bit when you start driving. Install the other knuckle in the same way, just make sure you get them the right way round. Remember, they are sided. The one with the double ball goes on the right of the picture. That just leaves the linkage, which goes across the bottom. We just use some pliers to clip it onto the balls. When we get to the next step, the short linkage will go from the top of the right hand knuckle to the servo saver. Step 24, the servo saver. We're going to need a 3x30 screw with a hex shape head, an M3 nylon nut, a servo saver spring, and a brass servo saver collar, plus the two servo saver plastic bits and the axle. These servo savers are quite notoriously bad. They work, but they don't really allow for any sort of precise steering. You'll use them for now though, just so we've got a baseline for the performance. To make the best of them, we're going to make sure the servo saver can move very freely and not bind up. The answer, more grease. The angled faces need a nice coat before we put them together, as does the outside. Now it's worth noting one of the axles has the top of the servo saver on the right of the axle and the other on the left. It's really the only difference between the two axles. In the top hole we need to pop in the spring and the collar. Again, a bit of extra grease really wouldn't hurt. From the bottom we insert the screw. The hole is hex shaped so the screw won't be able to turn, but we're still going to use a screwdriver so we have something to hold it up while we install the nut. Now the instructions say that we should have 3.5 millimeters of thread sticking up above the nut, which is all well and good, but it makes the steering extremely slack. Back when most people would be using the ACOM servo that came with the radio, with its low torque and plastic gears, having a soft steering was really the only way to have it survive. These days, even with a cheap metal gear servo, it's really not necessary. Before running, I'm going to tighten the nut up as far as I can before losing it down inside the hole. The servo saver's still going to work, but it's a lot stiffer than Tamiya recommend. Really though, with a metal gear servo, you'd quite easily get away with locking the servo saver entirely. There's enough flex in the rest of the linkage that you're never going to manage to damage anything. Now we just clip the short linkage in between the knuckle and the servo saver, and we can give it a quick test to make sure nothing binds up. Very nice. Step 25, the bumper. For this one, we need 4 M3x15s, 4 M3 flange nuts, and an F1, F2, and an F3. These are really simple to put together. All we need to do is pop a screw in from the outside and spin a nut on a couple of turns in each hole. Offer up the front bit of the bumper, which has slots that we pop under the nuts, and then we just tighten up the screws. The only thing to watch out for is overdoing the tightness. They only want to be snug plus a little bit extra. If you see the sides of the slots distort, you've probably overdone it. Pop all the screws in, nip them up, and that's step 25 done. Step 26, and the last step for today, fitting the bumper. All we need this time is 4 3x12 self-tappers. Now in a perfect world, all we do is offer up the bumper to the axles and screw in the screws. But I found the holes on the top of the braces were so far from the holes in the gearbox, there was no way to get the screws in. Looking in for the holes, they were off by a good 1.5 millimeters. I ended up taking the knuckles off again and tightening the bends in the ends of the braces until everything lined up. Not a very Tamiya problem. I can only assume that the jigs must be a good 30 years old and are simply just worn out. I'm sure that my old clodbuster build was okay. Either way, it's not great. After a bit of bending though, the screws went in and we're left with a complete axle ready for the next step. But we're going to need two axles, so here's the other one ready to go. Now as mentioned earlier, the only difference between them is the direction of the top of the servo saver, which the eagle-eyed among you might notice isn't what I did. I built two front axles. A bit annoying, but I did notice before getting too far into the next step, and it's easy enough to flip the arms around. I'm going to use my usual excuse and blame working on the truck way after I should have already been in bed. Anyway, that's it for this week. Next time we will be back on the chassis, making it a bit more like a truck, bringing all the bits together. As always then, thanks for watching, like if you liked, subscribe if you haven't, and leave a comment if there's something on your mind. Bye guys!